Good afternoon. My name is Dennis Williams. On behalf of Beta Alpha Belay of Sigma Pi Phi Fraternity, where our beloved brother and Archon, Earl Exum, was an active member, an officer, and a leader among leaders, an Archon's Archon, we'd like to send our sincere condolences to Tammy, her sons Evan, Kyle, Jonathan, and her family and friends. We will now conduct our Boule Omega ritual in honor of Archon Earl Evans Exum. Grammatus, what is the hour?
Sire Archon, it is the hour of destiny.
What great destiny calls us here?
The destiny of a man and of all men.
Then have we come to this hour to celebrate the life of a fellow Archon who has been called to his eternal rest?
It is for that we have come, Sire Archon.
Will you call the name of him whose loss we mourn and bring to our remembrance of his years with us?
Sire Archon, we bring to remembrance the life of Archon Earl Evans Exum, who contributed his light and learning to our fellowship and to this community.
Archon Agogos, please read for our inspiration the words of comfort from the Wisdom of Solomon.
Let us hear the message from the sacred record. The souls of the just are in God's hands, and there shall no torment touch them. In the sight of the unwise, they seem dead. Their departure is reckoned as defeat, and their going from us to be utter destruction. But they are at peace. For though they be punished in the sight of men, yet have they sure hope of immortality, because God has tested them and found them worthy to be his. Like gold in a crucible, he put them to the proof and found them acceptable, like an offering burnt whole upon the altar. And the Lord shall be their king forever and ever. Those who have put their trust in him shall understand that he is true, and the faithful shall attend upon him in love. They are his chosen, and grace and mercy shall be theirs. So ends the reading from the record.
Archons of Beta Iota Boule, it has been wisely said that the time and place of a man's life is the time and place of his body. But the meaning of a man's life is as eternal and significant as he, with all of him, wills to make it. These words are a key to the analysis of life of all of us. Archon Earl Evans Exum demonstrated those standards of excellence we all cherish and which are a vital part of our heritage. He exemplified the highest principles of his profession. In doing so, he walked in the ways of other notables who have gone before him. At the same time, he made his own unique contribution to human well-being. The true measure of a man's life is determined not by the tangible things he produces, but by the intangible qualities he possesses and the impact of these upon his fellow man. It is measured not in length of years, but by the extent to which he recognizes the abiding values of life, by his ability to distinguish between the true and the false, the superficial and the profound, and his ability to make courageous and responsible choices. Living in accordance with these ideals, Archon Earl Evans Exum's life was significant and meaningful. And for this, we celebrate his memory. We know full well that there's nothing truer to life than death, and that in due course, each of us will come to his moment of truth and destiny. As we bid farewell to our departed Archon, we have the assurances that his spirit rests in peace. Men of faith need to have no fear of the eternal future, for the souls of the righteous are in the hands of God. Let us pray. O thou who art the Lord of life, from whom we come, in whom we live, and whom we go, we praise your name for the life of Archon Earl Evans Exum and the legacy of dedication and commitment he bequeathed to those who follow in his train. Fostest to us courage in the midst of difficulties and the ability to see light in the midst of darkness. Despite our sense of loss, we must ever be fully aware that life goes on and new challenges must be met, always with the undergirding of your eternal presence. In this spirit, O Lord of life, we all pray and say, Amen.
John, chapter 11, verse 25. I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live.
O Master Eternal, give to each of us the deep consciousness of thy presence, that the spirit of fraternity may so direct our thoughts, guide and control our hearts and lives, that we may become through thee servants of all mankind. Amen.
O Father of life and giver of light, look with favor upon thy creatures here assembled.
And grant us thy blessing.
O thou who has led man through the ages of his existence upon the earth by thy spirit.
Grant us thy continued guidance.
Thou who thus generate love and goodness in hearts and a desire for fellowship one with the other in life's living.
Increase thy spirit.
Thou who hast called our brother from his task to the rewards of noble thought and deed.
Deepen our memory of him.
Thou who art the light of the new heaven, the new earth, the new Jerusalem, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end of all creation.
Grant a final resting place with thee to all thou hast called and finally ourselves.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'd like to ask the brothers of Nkande just to raise their hand for a moment so people can know who you are. 36 years ago, these gentlemen took a journey with Brother Earl Exum to join this fraternity, Alpha Phi Alpha. And during that journey, we created a bond that lasts for a lifetime and beyond. Earl was a leader amongst all of us, even though he was the youngest at the time and we didn't even know it. And he expressed his leadership in one way, in a little poem that was our line poem, and it went something like this. 10 great pillars standing rigid, poised, and ready, charged with intensity, the energy of mental force. John, help me out. Charged with attention, energy, and mental force. Ten great pillars standing rigid, poised, and ready. Together unshaken, untilted, and steady. Charged with intensity, the energy of mental force. Given guidance, our potential will soon take its course. Earl was always about bringing people together, and he lived his life in that manner. I had the pleasure of having Earl as not just my fraternity brother, but my friend for 2/3 of my life. have had the pleasure of spending time in the summers when we come to visit from the South with Earl and Tammy and their sons, and having daycations when they'd come to Florida. And I must tell you that I've watched Earl grow, not just as a man, but as a loving husband, as a doubting and devoted father, and as a man of God. The three things I do know is that Earl loved his family, he loved Alpha Phi Alpha, and he loved God. And so I know he's in a better place right now. One of my daughters told me that grief is just love trying to persevere. And so as we spend our time today celebrating the life of one of the greatest men I will ever know, I want you to appreciate that whatever you're experiencing inside, it's just your love for Earl pouring out. Thank you.
And now, may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.
Friends, we are an open and affirming congregation committed to being an anti-racist church as part of the United Church of Christ. My name is Reverend Erica Thompson, senior minister of this historic community of faith, and Earl Exum was this church's moderator. I want to welcome to this service of worship and celebration today Governor Ned Lamont, Lieutenant Governor Susan Bicewich, Secretary of the State Stephanie Thomas, State Comptroller Sean Scanlon, Senator Blumenthal, Congressman Larson, Speaker of the House Matt Ritter, House Majority Leader Jason Rojas, and all the General Assembly members who have gathered. I also welcome our mayors Luke Bronin from Hartford, Sherry Cantor of West Hartford, and Danielle Wong of Bloomfield. Hear now the words of the Lord. Comfort. Comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to the heart that they may know their sin is forgiven, their iniquity pardoned. Comfort. Comfort my people, says your God. Beloveds, these words were proclaimed by the prophet Isaiah thousands of years ago, spoken to a community that was brokenhearted, to people who were in desperate need of comfort and care. And these are words that speak to us today, because we too are brokenhearted. We too gather to find even a small measure of comfort. And in the very same breath, I want to remind us that we are not here only because Earl Exum has died. But we are also here because Earl Exum really lived. And he lived in such a way that his life, his love, his laughter, his convictions touched and shaped and changed us all. We are here because Earl lived, and life is a gift from God. And therefore, may our time together today be a celebration of life everlasting. May our time together be a celebration of God's triumph over death. So may each and every one of you find a sense of meaning in this place of worship. May all of us feel God's presence, and may we know comfort. Comfort, comfort my God, says your, comfort my people, says our God. If you would now rise in body or in spirit, and let us be called in to worship together. Beloveds, God is our light and our salvation. Whom shall we fear? God is our shelter and refuge on the days of trouble, and our hope and joy on the days of celebration. Day after day, we seek God's face and the assurance of God's holy love. O God, do not turn from us or hide your face from us. Be our guide and our light instead. One thing we ask of God, that we may live in God's dwelling place all the days of our life and never cease to behold the beauty of God's home. Beloved of God, enter this worship in thanksgiving, for God is among and within us. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Let us now pray together our unison prayer of invocation. Gracious light bearer, into the shadows of our sorrow, you speak words of life and community. Challenger of our lives, you call us from places we call home to lead us more deeply into the world you love. With your gentle, healing touch, you redeem the broken places of our lives, and you heal the wounded places of the earth. Inspire our worship here this day, so that we may receive liberation in your word and be filled to overflowing to share your reconciling love throughout the earth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
And I would call forward now Monica Howard to read Earl's obituary.
Good afternoon. I'm Monica Howard, Tammy's sister and Earl's sister-in-law. Early Exum was born in Queens, New York, as one of five children of the late Earl R. Exum and Kathleen Exum. He attended Middlesex High School before studying industrial labor relations at Cornell University. He went on to receive dual master degrees from Purdue University, a MS in management, and École Supérieure de Commerce de Rouen, France, an MBA in international business. He held a Certificate of Management, Business Strategy from the University of Virginia, and a Directorship Certification from the National Association of Corporate Directors. Earl met the love of his life, Tammy Rush, in 1993, while in Atlanta, Georgia, through a chance encounter with a mutual friend. Excited to start their new lives together, the two were married September 30th, 1995, in Charlotte, North Carolina. Earl was chairman of International Aero Engines and vice president of commercial engines at Pratt & Whitney, where he served for over 27 years. While at Pratt & Whitney, Earl held positions in operations, aftermarket, overhaul and repair, materials management, continuous improvement, sales, and human resources. He was the chair and founder of Pratt & Whitney's African American Forum, which has grown into the Black Excellence Network. Earl was also an independent board member, director for A.O. Smith Corporation, a publicly traded S&P 500 company, where he served on the audit committee. Earl was a devoted member of Asylum Hill Congregational Church in Hartford, where he served in various leadership positions over the years, and most recently as moderator. He was a true servant in his church and also had a passion for children, education, and supporting the growth and advancement of the Black community. Earl served on the board of the Urban League of Greater Hartford, where he was formerly treasurer. He was on the board of advisors for the Supply Change Management Program at Howard University Business School. Earl was president of West Hartford African American Social and Cultural Organization, and also served on the Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Advisory Council for the CEO of Raytheon Technologies Corporation. He most recently was appointed to the board of Hartford Foundation for Public Giving. Earl's dedication and commitment to the community was unwavering. He was the chair of the curatorial committee for the Tuskegee Airmen exhibit at the New England Air Museum. He was an officer for Sigma Pi Phi fraternity, Beta Iota Boule in Farmington Valley, Connecticut, and was the member of the Executive Leadership Council. Earl served on the planning committee for the annual summer executive workshop, Black Economic Forum. Formerly, Earl was president of the board of directors for WHC-TV in West Hartford, Connecticut. He was a Cub Scout leader, and he coached football, basketball, and baseball in the West Hartford Youth Leagues. Earl was a devoted father and a pillar of strength for his family. Everyone who knew Earl knew how much he loved to dance with his wife, Tammy. He was often the first to hit the dance floor. He had a passion for reading nonfiction and history books and was a sports buff. He especially loved to watch, coach, and play football, which he really enjoyed doing with his sons. Earl had a passion for fitness and never missed his early morning walks and workouts. Above all, Earl's greatest joy was spending time with his family. He leaves to cherish his memory, his wife of 28 years, Tammy, his sons, Evan Earl, Cal Edmund, and Jonathan Lee, his siblings, Evelyn Exum, Eileen Exum, Eric Exum, Ildiko, Ellen Exum, Neil, his sister-in-law, Monica Howard, and father-in-law, Franklin Lee Rush Eula, along with a host of nieces and nephews and his close friends. May the work Earl has done speak for him. Thank you.
And I would now call forward Eileen Exum, Earl's sister, Mark Michael, a childhood friend, and Larry Jones, a mentor and former colleague, to share with us some remembrances.
As we, the Exum siblings, stand here before you, we are overwhelmed by the love we feel in honor of our dear brother. We all deeply feel this loss, and I'm very saddened we are gathered here under these circumstances. I have no intentions to question the Most High, but I can speak for many of you. This happened too soon. Everyone here knows our brother differently. And each of you had your own relationship with him. But to us, he was number one of the Exum Five. He was our big brother. Even though he was only 10 months older than my twin and I, his spirit was so grand, we all viewed him as our big brother. He led by example. He set the bar high. And as he achieved, he demonstrated to each of us how we could also. He exceeded at most everything he did, except cooking. Though to his defense, as a young man, he did master grilled cheese and toast. He was a great communicator and negotiator. Growing up with Earl, he gave us nothing for free, except advice. He many times talked me into ironing his clothes for a ride in that 1977 Thunderbolt. He taught me not much in this life is free. And even as a sister, I was not entitled to a ride. Everything was earned. He was a great supporter. Growing up, the boys played football on the triangle in the street. He would let my twin and I play if they were a man short. Many, many moons ago, when he played for the Rosedale Jets, I didn't think it was fair that girls couldn't play football. I tried to advocate for us to play. He agreed to help me. Then one day before practice, with his shoulder pads on and all, he tackled me. And as I lied there crying, he helped me up and said, "If you can't take a hit, you can't play." Needless to say, I didn't talk too much about playing football after that. But he taught me to pick my fights wisely and to be prepared to get knocked down. And he would be there to help me up. He was truly a great big brother. And as I reflect on my dear brother, I am inspired, because in the 55 years he lived his life, he accomplished more than many in a lifetime. He never just showed up. He always gave it his all. And in honor of his life and his too soon departure, we, his siblings, Eileen Earl Exum, Evelyn Earl Exum,
don't say it.
Eric Earl Exum,
don't say it.
Ellen E. Exum, ask you to honor his memory by not just showing up, but to live each moment. No more, do more, be more, celebrate life, because tomorrow is not promised.
So So I prepared a really long speech. In fact, I prepared about 10 sermons telling what great roots Earl came from and how amazing of a brother he was. Then I realized if I can't make it through writing the words without soaking the pages, I wasn't gonna be able to say much in front of you without breaking down. I also realized that you're here because you, our spouses, Tammy and the boys, and my sisters already know Earl was a better father, husband, brother, uncle, and friend we could have even known to ask for. I can speak for my sisters, what I say, as his younger siblings, we did our job and we did it well. From the time we came into this world, we tested Earl's patience. I think my dad told me the day I was born, I tried to arm wrestle Earl for his pacifier. Earl was a one-man village. It's no surprise how many outstanding people showed up today to celebrate Earl's life on Earth. But everyone needs to keep showing up for years to come. It's gonna take a huge village to fill the gaps Earl left behind. Whatever universe you are called to make better, I just hope that they love and appreciate you as much as we do. I love and miss you so much, Earl.
Good afternoon. My name is Mark Michael. I met Earl in my freshman year at Cornell University. My meeting with him was a happenstance. I was in a temporary location, temporary room, and I randomly got assigned to live with Earl. By that time, friend networks had already been formed. By many of the, you know, at that time, many of the black students hung together, and many of the black students were either in the summer program, Earl was an athlete, along with other folks were athletes, or they shared a common bond from being in New York. I was neither of those things, but Earl welcomed me into the friend group with open arms. Didn't matter I didn't play football or was from New York. And frankly, he was a key reason that I became a member of the fraternity Alpha Phi Alpha. Two things that stand out to me about our college experience. Earl could always be counted on to be a brother that got stuff done. You know, like it was said before, he put his heart into everything that he did. And, you know, that's not necessarily the case for everyone, but Earl was, you could always count on him. The other thing that stood out to me was that his network and his friends was very deep. It wasn't uncommon for students at the time, you know, especially fraternity rows, to pledge and have your entire social network consist of your brothers. But Earl was different. He maintained relationships not only outside of the Cornell Alpha chapter, but also of the broader fraternity. One thing comes to mind: his closeness to Kester Hodge, who was up on stage with us, who ultimately ended up pledging Alpha, was clear. Everyone knew that, even though Kester pledged in his senior year, and he was still Kester's Earl's boy, and we all knew that he was as close with Kesha as he was with us. That was unique within our friend group, and there was nothing that he wouldn't do for Kester, even though he wasn't one of us at the time. You know, and when I think about the post-college years, we didn't see each other as often, but we didn't need to connect all the time. He was always there for the big events. He was at our wedding. We were at Earl and Tammy's wedding, and whenever a blast would go out for a dinner or a similar event, you know, Earl was always one of the first to respond, "I'll be there," regardless of where he was. he was a family man. That, you know, that much is clear. And you know, and whenever we got together, the conversations largely revolved around family. How's your family doing? You know, what's Tammy doing? He spoke adoringly about Tammy, and especially about her commitment to the community as an elected official. And he was also very proud of his sons, you know, Evan, Kyle, and Jonathan, and kept us up on their progress. You know, so you know, you boys, you know, you didn't know that we knew what you were doing, but we rest assured we did. You're always part of our conversations. You know, fast forward in recent years, you know, we saw more of Earl and Tammy and Jonathan a little bit because, you know, he was around, you know, and, you know, I remember a drive. I was going down I-95 and we were thinking about, and I gave Earl a call, and we were thinking about buying a house on Martha's Vineyard, and it gave us a great degree of comfort knowing that Tammy and Earl were close to purchasing their home at that time. You know, knowing that I had a close friend that had similar thoughts sealed the deal for us, and we ended up purchasing a home there. And you know, whenever we were on island or were planning to be on island, you know, we would always email or text each other to make sure that we could connect, get, you know, assuming our schedules could align. You know, I think, you know, my the one remaining goal that I had was to convince Earl that he should spend more time on a golf course with me and not, you know, not just, you know, go on his morning walks as he used to do around Oak Bluffs. It wasn't successful, but, you know, I thought I had a lot of time. You know, I'm having a hard time, frankly, processing this. You know, this has hit me, you know, pretty hard. But I know that Earl is in a better place. Rest in peace, my good brother. You have more than earned it.
Well, good afternoon. My name's Larry Jones, and those of you who can read already know that. And I had the privilege of having Earl Exum call me his friend. And I really, really think of that as a privilege. And it is a deep honor for me to be able to stand here and say a few words about my friend, Earl Exum. Now, I met Earl soon after he joined Pratt & Whitney, so I've known Earl basically all of his career. And it was, you know, it was immediately apparent to me that he was different. He was different because he had skills, just a multitude of skills and characteristics that exceeded just about anybody else I had met anywhere. And you've heard about some of those, so I won't go through every single one. But the one thing that most impressed me about Earl Exum was his optimism. A lot of managers know how to get things done. They can count the widgets. They can go out and say the right things to the employees. They can say the right things to the bosses. But they don't have that spark. They don't have that element of grace, of compassion, of caring, and of kindness. Earl had all of those in spades. And, oh, by the way, he had all those managerial talents, too. So Earl was a formidable, formidable individual. But again, the thing that impressed me the most about Earl, well, Earl always had a smile on his face no matter how bad it got. I don't care how bad it got, Earl was always smiling. And there's a former president who told a story about a little boy who had been, you know, for Christmas wishing for a pony. He'd been wishing, been telling his parents, man, I really want this pony. And they lived on a farm. And come Christmas morning, little kid jumps up, runs out, goes into the corral. He's looking around, no pony. So you know what he did? He did what Earl Exum would have done. He started digging through that big pile of manure, just like Earl did when he was looking for spare parts. And I will tell you, at Pratt & Whitney and in the jet engine business, you can have small problems and you can have large problems. And we used to say, spare parts solve all problems. Because if you can get them spares, you can deal with it. So I see Earl like that little boy. No matter how bad things got, Earl kept that smile on his face, and he kept digging through that pile, because he knew somewhere in there was a pony. Earl used data. Earl would not suffer fools. If you weren't prepared, if you were not prepared to debate with Earl, you'd best just leave your debate at home. Because he knew facts. He didn't deal in hyperbole. He didn't deal in a bunch of, I feel this way. It was always about the facts. But again, the thing that impressed me the most was his optimism. Now, Earl's multitude of talents don't get bestowed on many people. And most of us just can't get there. But all of us have two things in common with Earl Exum. We all got born, and we're all in a race, and there's a third one, by the way, and we're all in the race of life. Some of us who start to look a little bald about the head, gray more than in the temples, and short of memory, we might be in a marathon. We might be in a marathon. I hope so. There are others who don't know it, but they're running a mid-distance race, maybe a 1,600 meters. And then there are those who also don't know it, because the third thing that we all have in common with Earl Exum, being born, being in the race of life, the third thing is we're all blind to where the finish line is. We're all blind to where we're going to end up. Earl ran in the third category of races. He ran sprints. And for some of you who don't know this, Earl played football at Cornell. He was a halfback, or a running back in today's terms. And so Earl had to be quick. He had to be speedy. He had to have some moves, and on the dance floor, he demonstrated them with Tammy often. They were a beautiful couple on the dance floor. But all of us are just like Earl in the face of time. And unfortunately, that clock is ticking all the time, and we don't know when it's going to stop. For Earl, it stopped way, way too soon. But Earl was a sprinter. Earl was a sprinter. Earl didn't do anything slow. He didn't do anything halfway. I had to think about that one. He didn't do anything halfway. When Earl was in, he was all in. And it didn't matter whether it was about the community or about his friends, about his craft, and mostly it didn't matter, because you've heard this before and this is a recurring thing, it really didn't matter, because the one thing that you could count on was that Earl was about his family. That is just a given. The last conversation I had with Earl was about 3 weeks ago, and this is the kind of person he was. So I had sent Earl a text. And by the way, it was probably all scrambled, because I'm old and I'm not into technology, you know, so it's probably scrambled. But anyway, and I didn't hear anything back from Earl. Very unusual. Very unusual. Earl responds like now to just about anybody, anytime. So I got a little concerned, and I called a mutual friend, and I said, hey, man, what's going on with Earl? Is there anything? Is he all right? He goes, yeah, best I know, nothing's happening. Unbeknownst to me, Greg Jones called Earl and said, hey, Larry said, you know, you sent him a text Or he sent you a text and you didn't respond and he was really concerned about you. Now this is, you know, like call this a Wednesday. Thursday morning, I get a call from Earl. Hey, Larry, how you doing? Say, Greg told me that, you know, that you sent me a text and somehow I didn't get it. And I go, well, okay, well, that makes sense. Now, it's probably, I mean, I probably sent that off into the ether someplace in the Netherlands or somewhere. And, but that demonstrates the kind of person that Earl was. Soon as he heard that I was concerned, he didn't wait for me to call him. He called me. And then we proceeded to talk for a good while. And all of our conversations throughout our time together always started off with, how are you doing in your work? And then we transitioned to, okay, what are your career aspirations? What's next? That was always the short part of the conversation. The long part of the conversation was about what he was doing in the community, how he was helping other people. The longer part was about his family. He would always tell me how proud he was of his boys, how well they were doing, how he could help them and he would help them. And then he turned to Tammy. And I didn't know this because, you know, I'm not too deep into politics, but Earl told me in this conversation that Tammy had gotten some legislation passed. And I said, that's great, Earl. He said, no, you don't understand, Larry. Tammy wrote the legislation. It wasn't a bunch of staffers. Tammy wrote that legislation. And it's not about the kind of legislation that you see in the news and you see on TV. It's not about the clicks on social media. It's not about the photo ops. Tammy isn't into that. Tammy is going to work, unlike a lot of people don't do, to make sure that her legislation gets implemented. And he was so unabashedly proud of his family, all the time, every day. Now, if Earl were here right now, he'd look out and see all of you, and he, who was not easily impressed, would be impressed. That is a testament to who Earl was. And oh, by the way, who Earl is. Because Earl's body isn't here with us today, that doesn't mean that Earl is gone. For me, Earl is unforgettable. His spirit is so powerful that if you are like me, Earl's name will never leave your lips. Every now and then you'll think, wow, Earl would have done this. Let me be like Earl. So the greatest thing that all of us could do would be to live just a little bit like Earl. My friend Earl has run his race. He ran a sprint. And I can tell you that Earl never ever gave a thought to run a marathon. He never gave a thought to run a mid-distance race. He was always sprinting. And I will say, at close here, without question, Earl Exum won his race.
Thank you.
Amen. Now it is my honor to invite forward Stephanie Abrams of the New England Air Museum, Dentaya Williams, a work colleague of Earl's, and Sean Wooden, one of Earl's friends.
Good afternoon. I'm Stephanie Abrams, President and CEO of the New England Air Museum. When I got the call earlier this week, like most of you, I was shocked and I was devastated. It took me almost 4 hours to be able to inform my staff, some of who were remote, with an email that said, "I cannot believe I'm even typing these words, but Earl Exum has passed away." Now, many of you might not know about the special relationship many of us at the New England Air Museum had with Earl. We were blessed to have this relationship with Earl. Some years ago, when the RTX Black Excellence Network called and asked us to put together a video to help Pratt & Whitney employees celebrate Black History Month, at the end of the many Zoom calls talking about content, I took a deep breath because I knew they were going to say he's way too busy, but I said, would it be possible for Earl to be the on-camera host of the video? And of course it was. Let us see, let's talk to Earl, he's traveling. The same day, I got an email from Earl saying, I'd be honored. So I knew he was traveling the week before we were doing the filming. And so he called me the night before, and we agreed that, I know it's early, but we're gonna begin filming at 6:30 the next morning. And I said, do you want me to send you the script so you can take a look at it? And he said, no, I'll look at it in the morning. Now, for someone who spent many decades as a writer director for television, I had a little bit of a panic attack. I said, okay. So Earl comes early the next morning, he reads the script, he made a couple of improvements, and I took him before the crew, and he nailed it in the first take. So then he said, you know, why don't we do a couple of other versions of this just to make sure that we get it right, and maybe you can reuse it for some other things. So I said, okay, but of course I'm worried about a schedule. So while we're resetting and getting other angles in front of the trainer that the Tuskegee Airmen actually were trained in, Earl's asking my crew about their families. He talked about his family. He was beaming with love and pride. And he did tell some pretty funny stories. But then we kept saying, Earl, you're worried about your schedule. And he said, no, we have to get this right, especially the young engineers at Pratt & Whitney. They have to understand that they stand on the shoulders of giants. So, sometime later, we began designing our Tuskegee exhibit. And we decided, you know, let's make this different than the Tuskegee exhibits that existed so many other museums. We wanted to tell the story through the few still living Tuskegee Airmen and their friends and their families. So it was a walk in these shoes kind of experience. So again, I got in touch with Earl, took a deep breath, and asked the impossible. I asked if he'd be willing to be the chair of our steering committee. And Earl said, I'd be honored. Earl not only said yes, in quintessential Earl style, he took this on. He was in, as the earlier speaker, I can't believe I have to follow, said. He made an unwavering exhibit to bring this, unwavering effort to bring this exhibit to life. He was spreading the word, he was fundraising, but Earl also took the stage with me at every fundraiser to an audience of well over 100 people. Anyone who has not had the opportunity of being on stage with Earl, it is a magical experience. He lit up the stage. He has a way of connecting with every single person in the audience. I often would tease him and say, you know, with you as my co-anchor here, if I lose my place, I'm just gonna say Earl. So, of course, at the last event that we co-hosted, it was the night before the exhibit was actually going to open, and of course we have a show rundown. So it was a long evening, and the airmen had been up all day. Now imagine you're doing an event for four people, ultimately, who are going to be on stage with the incredible Leslie Mays. 98, 99, and two of them were 100. So my staff comes and whispers to me behind my ear, Stephanie, one of them is falling asleep. We gotta move this up. So Earl and I got prepared to do that. Then my other staff member comes over and she said, Stephanie, Eugene is going to the restroom. And so I just looked at Earl and he gave me that smile and up we went. And we ad-libbed and told stories until Eugene was back. I'm told it was done with grace and humor, but quite frankly, I don't think I could have done it if I didn't have Earl standing there beside me. Thank you, because I feel that Earl is standing beside me right now, helping me control my emotions as I finish. In honor of Earl's legacy, we'll be placing a memorial at the entrance of our Tuskegee exhibit. This memorial will serve as a way of forever continuing Earl's legacy of fostering values of determination and excellence, and using them, as he did, to forge a brighter future in the hearts and minds of our youth. Earl's legacy will forever be woven into the fabric of our museum. His loss is beyond difficult to process. However, Earl will forever hold a special place in our hearts, and his memory will continue to inspire us every day for the years ahead. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I don't think I'm going to share anything new that you haven't already heard today, but I had the pleasure to see Earl in action at work, in the community, and as a husband. And Earl started his career in Pratt & Whitney in HR. He would tell everybody that he started in HR. And I've been in HR for 25 years, and I think it was 2 years for him, but he was always giving me guidance on what I needed to do to be better for our people. But I do think that being HR, he was a shadow HR person because he cared so much about people, developing people, and making sure that we had an environment where they could thrive. And even though I took his advice, I didn't always tell him, but I always took his advice and guidance. I was very intentional about not being his mentee. Because I know a lot, like I see a lot of his mentees in the room, and you had to work hard for Earl to be your mentor. Like, you had to read books, you had to come prepare for the meetings, because in his mind, he's like, you know what, if I'm putting in the time, because I'm a very busy person, then you gotta put in the time so that I can fill you up. You gotta deserve it, right? And once he did that, and let me just back up a little bit. I thought that it was Greg Jones and Larry Jones and Shelley Stewart. I thought it was your fault, so I apologize. It sounds like he's just been that way his whole life. So forgive me for thinking it was your fault. But I think the really beautiful thing about it is the fact that once they did the work and he did the work, he would become the ultimate sponsor to make sure that his proteges did great things. You know, another thing that Earl was like very committed to was diversity. And like, don't get it twisted. It wasn't just about black people. Like, it was about women, it was about young people, it was about all people of color. Like, he really pushed for diversity. And what's really, thank you. And you see that in the room here, but the neat thing about it is our CEO, Greg Hayes, noticed Earl many, many years ago. And in 2020, he's very committed to diversity. He started a diversity, equity, and inclusion council. And the first and perhaps only name he mentioned that had to be on the advisory board was Earl. And so he knew that he would use his voice to hold us accountable so that we would drive progress. So that was always so meaningful for us. And I know that he used his voice in the community. When he saw something, a person in need, or an issue that needed to be addressed, he addressed it. So I was at events this week, and I thought he was going to walk through the door. But it was important for us to still be there. And it'll be hard to be in the community without him. Earl was an awesome human being. Everybody this week thinks they're his best friend. Everybody talked about how close they were to Earl, so that is how he made them feel, right? And I think I was the favorite at work, maybe, I don't know. But let me tell you, he did a lot of things. He was an awesome human being, but he would tell you that the best thing he did was be Tammy's husband. And it's so funny because when we were working together every day, like, he would be really excited when it was like birthday time or anniversary time, and he would come in, he was like, this is what I'm gonna do to surprise her. And every year Tammy was surprised, but she knew it was gonna be a surprise. Like, and he would always like outdo himself the next year. And I just loved like waiting for it. Like, I was on the edge of my seat every year, like, ooh, what are we doing this year? So it was just so awesome to see that. I just want to tell this one story. So I kind of knew who Earl was just, you know, for many years. And I hadn't been in Connecticut long, but this was over a decade ago when I had this conversation with him, like the first real conversation that I had with Earl. And he was working on this project that I think Larry sort of referenced earlier today. And literally, he was working 24/7. And it was so bad, like the work hours, that he had to actually go to his supervisor and say, look, I gotta have 3 hours on Sunday to go to church, and then I will be back. So he had to request 3 hours just to come and worship. But he came to me and he said, you know, I think my wife Tammy would like you. And can I give you her number? And can y'all start hanging out? Because he felt so bad that he just couldn't be there as much as he wanted to. And I was like, this guy is outsourced. So anyway, but then I met Tammy, and it was like, she was such a blessing. We got to hang out, my husband and I got to hang out with Earl and Tammy, and it's just been such a blessing, and I'm like so glad that he did that. And you know, one thing that I think is just so important, like Earl told me to take care of you. And so, my request to everyone in this room, one, is this shouldn't be the last day of support. This is the first day. And when we're out, and when you go out and you see somebody in need or something needs to be done, just ask yourself, what would Earl do? And just go do it. Thank you.
Good afternoon, church. First, let me just acknowledge how truly grateful and honored I am to stand up here as a friend of Earl's. Clearly, if you just look around, Earl had a lot of friends. And so I'm truly honored to stand here and to celebrate the life of Earl, my friend and brother. So much has already been said about Earl as a brother, as a professional, as his contributions to the community. I kind of really just feel like I should just stop right now and sit down. But as a former politician, I just can't do that. I will share a few stories about my relationship with Earl that I hope will add some color to what you've already heard about him as a man and as a friend. And now we're here today to celebrate Earl. But as everyone in this room knows, you can't think about Earl without thinking about the love of his life, Tim. The two of them reflected the best of what I think about when I think about love, when I think about marriage. A true partnership centered in faith and family. After Tammy entered the political world, I just loved seeing Earl beam with pride in her accomplishments. As a man, he was as steady, as strong, as accomplished as any man could be. But that strength and that love allowed him to be Robin next to Tammy's Batman. And I love that about him. I first met Earl and Tammy at an Amistad event at the Wadsworth Athenaeum, and I instantly knew that they were two very special people. Over the years, we socialized together periodically. However, it was after my own divorce that our relationship really deepened. Whenever I needed to spend time with a friend, I could always call on Earl to be there. Now, this is certainly reflective of who Earl is as a man and as a friend to anyone in need, but it quickly became clear to me that Tammy was a big part of this as well. Occasionally, I would call Earl about getting together, and he would say, Sean, I'd love to. He said, but I got this thing to do with Tammy tonight. And invariably, like within 10 minutes, he would call me back, and he would say, hey, we can go out. And so the first couple of times that this happened, I would say to him, oh, what changed? Tammy doesn't have an event, Tammy. He was like, no, Tammy overheard us talking. And she said, you don't need to come with me, go out with Sean. This was significant in several respects. One, it was illustrative of the fact that Earl always put family first, always. Two, Earl was an excellent listener and advisor for me and so many others. Three, as many of you know, he barely drank alcohol, so he was a great designated driver when we went to a bar. And four, I just always knew that they both had my back unconditionally. And I don't know if I've ever thanked you, Tammy, for the number of times you loaned Earl to me in those early years, but I want to thank you now. Thank you. That was very generous. Now, on one of our evening outings, Earl came to my house to pick me up. He always drove. He was the designated driver. And as soon as I got into his car, he got a call from Tammy saying, Earl, Teddy was barking, the dog, and we think there's a bear outside. I don't know if you remember this, Tammy. And true to form, Earl says, all right, we'll turn around, we'll be right there. Now, we're driving back to the house together, and I have no idea what's supposed to happen when we get there. We arrive at the house, and I go into the kitchen with Tammy while Earl goes to the garage to get a golf club. It's dark outside. I'm in the kitchen with Tammy and Teddy, wondering what is Earl going to do if he encounters the bear? Does he really think a golf club is gonna work? And finally, I started to think, if my friend is out there, what am I doing in this house? So I decided to go out and join him for the bear hunt around the house with a flashlight and a golf club. Still having no clue what we were gonna do if we found the bear, but I knew that my friend Earl would do the same for me. And I had to be there, no matter what we encountered, to be with him. We didn't find a bear that night. Not saying you were wrong, Tammy. But Tammy felt better. And Earl felt better that Tammy felt better. And the two of us proceeded to go out to get a B-E-E-R for me and a soda for Earl. Now, over the years, I would often share things with Earl in confidence. And if I said anything really important to him, he would always say, "Is it all right if I tell Tammy?" He loved Tammy, and they were one union with no secrets. I understood that very early on in our relationship. So although I never told Earl, this was actually like a private joke with me, waiting for Earl to ask the question, "Is it all right if I tell Tammy?" And I would always say, "Of course." Now, Earl was also really smart, thoughtful, intellectually curious, civically engaged, and actually very, very funny. He was a busy, high-performing senior executive in a major corporation, but he was also kind, loyal, humble. He was a big deal. But despite how large he was in our local community and around the world, he was still a friend that I could call to just help me move the boxes out of my garage. Remember that, Dennis? Now, our Alpha Phi Alpha fraternity's motto is, first of all, servants of all, we shall transcend all. Well, I think we can agree that Earl epitomized this motto, and he is now transcended. And for a man like Earl, I can't help but think about the scripture in Matthew chapter 25, verse 23, which reads, "His Lord said unto him, Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, and I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." Earl's body has physically left this worldly place, but he was indeed a faithful servant. He's in heaven now, and I know God has already had the well done, good and faithful servant conversation with Earl. And as for us, left here, we all know that Earl will live on in our hearts, in our minds. And Earl also lives on in his children. So to Evan, Kyle, Jonathan, I want you to know that Earl left you with a room full of brothers, sisters, of family that are here for you. We're here for you to lift you up. We're here for you to catch you when you stumble and fall. That's today, that's tomorrow, that's forever. Know that. And I'm going to close by asking for all of your help in preserving Earl's memory, his legacy. At Tammy's request, we've established the Earl E. Exum Memorial Fund at the Hartford Foundation for Public Giving to continue to support the community efforts that Earl was so passionate about. I want to thank the foundation for literally responding. We must have had the conversation about 9 or 9:30 at night, and within 24 hours, we had this foundation established and set up and ready to take the money in. I know because I hit send. And I got to tell you, and I will thank, going off script a little bit here, but I will thank everyone for the outpouring of love and support that you have showered this family with. It has been absolutely incredible. The church, the legislature, the West Hartford community, the Connecticut community, the national community. I want to thank you for that, you know, on behalf of the family. But I got to tell you that I don't think I saw a bigger smile the entire week, a greater sense of satisfaction in this loss and that this tragedy could turn into something really good. I didn't see a bigger reaction out of Tammy than when Dennis and I told her it's done. That sense of we have something to help continue Earl's work here. So this doesn't just end today. Earl ran a sprint, you know, and I only disagree with my good friend Larry a little bit. Earl ran sprint after sprint after sprint after sprint after sprint. But his work and life can live on through this foundation and through his children. So please join me in supporting both of them. Thank you.
Dad, RIP, you were my best friend in the world, the best father, best human being, a rare talent. Without you, I wouldn't have been able to play sports, to work out, do homework. I really hated school, but you pushed me to do my homework and study. I wouldn't have been able to be successful or be able to pass high school or get a college degree without you. You were my best friend in the world. I would call you every single day. That one time my roommate said, you're more parent dependent than everyone. Then I said back, that's my best friend in the world, so I could call him every day. I miss you to death. I will keep working hard for you. I will talk to you in my heart every day. And last thing, Dad, the number one thing that I promise is that I will protect your legacy and I will grow your legacy. Love you, Dad.
Little kid, and I would wake up at 4 a.m. and you would say, let's go downstairs and play Lego so that we didn't wake up my mom. You showed me that I could be anything I wanted to be. So when I wanted to be a YouTuber, you didn't even know what that was. but he just completely supported me. And even when I was 9 and I had a plan to use my college fund to buy a camper so that I didn't have to go get a job and buy a house, you 100% supported me. And if that's really what I wanted to do, I truly believe you would have let me do that. You showed up consistently to games. But that's the thing, you didn't just show up. You wouldn't just be the supportive parent, you would be the coach of the team. When I was at Howard, you know, you would join the board. You went above and beyond in everything I did, and no matter what, you were there for me. Whenever I called, a text, or anything, you were there. You let me explore my creativity, and all the millions of questions I asked you to this day, you just would always have the answer or know how to find the answer. You taught me to be competitive, finally beat you in Connect Four. Like, you did not get an easy setup for kids, but you loved us dearly and loved my mom. And you taught me it's easy to work hard when you love what you're doing. So I'm never gonna stop chasing what I love and being with the people I love. You made those 25 years feel like 100. I love you, Dad, and I'm gonna miss you.
You know, my dad was a great man, a really patient man, and stuck by me, and he did understand me. We would talk about so many different things, one big thing being rap music we would talk about constantly, like car rides and stuff. We would talk about college, growing up and stuff. I realized he was also a big motivator for me. That thought process I had around this stuff, this dedication, I realized comes a lot from him. My dad was a very hard worker. He had a soft spot though for his family, for his kids. He did not put his work before us. My dad did so much, and he would do anything to fit me into his schedule, fit everyone else into his schedule and all that, because he loved us. I realized he was a funny guy too. There were times where he would make everyone laugh without even trying to make a joke. He's my hero. It's so different living in this house, not hearing my dad's very familiar footsteps. Truly grateful that I had my dad for the 17 years that I did have my dad. I'm glad that we could celebrate his life and all his accomplishments. Rest in peace to my dad, man. I love you.
So I want to make right one error. When I was welcoming all of our dignitaries, somehow I left out State Treasurer Eric Russell, so welcome. As State Treasurer and the businessman that Earl was, I think that would be an error that he would not want left out. But I would like to now call forward our Lieutenant Governor Susan Bicewich and State Senator Derek Slapp.
Good afternoon, everyone. Earl may be the most impressive person I have ever met. So successful, so kind, so devoted to the community, and of course, so devoted to his family. So it is my honor, it is heartbreaking, but it is my honor to present this citation from the General Assembly and memoriam. Be it hereby known to all that the Connecticut General Assembly extends its sincerest condolences and expressions of sympathy to the Exum family on the passing of Earl Evans Exum. Beloved father, husband, brother, and friend, the impact of Earl's leadership, kindness, and love is vast, deep, and everlasting to his family, especially his children. May they know that their father's remarkable legacy will live on forever. Our deepest condolences to the entire Exum family and all those who were blessed to witness Earl's beauty. This is introduced by the West Hartford delegation on this seventh day of October 2023, and signed by the Senate President and the Speaker of the House and the Secretary of the State. But I'm going to take the liberty to say that every single member of the General Assembly's signature is on this citation, so many of whom are here right now. We love you, Tammy. We love Earl. We love the Exum family. And you, Mr. Rush, we love you.
Good afternoon. I also have a citation from the state of Connecticut expressing the condolences of Governor Lamont and myself on the passing of Earl Exum. And I'm not going to read it because it is similar to the one that Senator Slapp just read. But I want to say to Tammy, Evan, Kyle, and Jonathan, and the Exum family, is that the state of Connecticut has lost a precious and beautiful treasure. Earl lived an exemplary life, and to all of us in this church and beyond are so inspired by his leadership, his advocacy, his generosity of spirit. And I will say on behalf of pretty much the entire state legislature, state leadership, West Hartford and Avon town government, that the leaders who work alongside you, Tammy, recommit ourselves to live Earl's legacy in our work. And Earl had a mission, and you've heard it, but if you had to sum it up, it was to work for equity, equality, and opportunity for everyone. So I know that our colleagues in state government will work to further those ends. And Earl was so very proud of the bill that you wrote, landmark youth mental health legislation that is being copied by states all across the country. And I know Earl would want to see not just that it was written and passed, but that it is fully funded and implemented so that all our young people have the support that they deserve. God bless all of you. Our state expresses our incredible condolences to your family. We love you and we will be here for you.
And I also want to call forward State Representative Corey Paris, who has a citation from the Black and Puerto Rican Legislative Caucus.
To the entire Exum family, the West Hartford community, the entire state of Connecticut, who mourn the loss of our dear friend Earl Exum, the Black and Puerto Rican Caucus extends its sincerest condolences and expression of sympathy to those who loved him and knew him best. Our joys will be greater, our love will be fuller, because we shared a moment in time together with him, through you, Tammy, and with him personally. To the entire Exum family, once again, our thoughts and prayers are with you. Signed on this day, October 7th. Thank you.
Friends, let us join our hearts together now in prayer. Holy and gracious God, whose ways are not our ways and whose thoughts are not our thoughts, grant that your Holy Spirit may intercede for us. Heal our wounded hearts made heavy by our sorrow. For those of us who are finding it hard to find the words to express what we are feeling today, God, give us the wisdom to seek out the language we need to authentically express. But also grant us the grace to be kind to ourselves as we navigate something none of us ever thought we would be doing right now. God, you know what is on our hearts. And we know that our thoughts and our feelings are safe with and never too much for you to handle. God of comfort and mercy, be with those of us who are not quite sure how we're going to get through the next hour or day or week. Remind us that taking it one step at a time is really all any of us needs to do right now. That no one needs to promise perfect ways forward, and that if we can stay in community with each other and offer love to each other, finding the path forward actually becomes possible. God, may we remember that with each new breath we take throughout those hours and days and weeks, we become better able to forge new paths forward. God, stay with us on this journey and give us strength for each new step we take. God, we belong to you, and nothing could ever separate us from you. We rest in the assurance that our beloved Earl is safe with you. Fill our minds with his sweet memory and our hearts with his love so that we can make this world a better place. In honor of him. God, show us how to do that so that we can make him proud and carry his love into our lives forever. God, we pray all of this knowing that you sent us your Son, who taught us to pray and how to love And so now we lift our voices to pray with the words that he gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I now invite Africa Hines, AHCC's vice moderator, forward to share with us John 14 and Reverend Franklin Rush to share with us 1 Corinthians 13.
To the Exum family and friends, may these promises of faith set deep in your heart and be with you always. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way of the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him.
If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith, so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. For knowledge it comes to an end. For we know only in part, and we do prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I reasoned like a child. But when I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now abides hope, faith, love. But the greatest of these is love. The word of God for God's people.
Let us pray. God, we ask that you would come now with a word of comfort, with a word of care, with a word of love. Amen. So this year, here at Asylum Hill Congregational Church, our worship and program theme is to know and be known. It is a theme that Earl, as our church moderator, loved. After more than 3 years of living through a devastating, life-altering pandemic, he and I talked often about our common desire to help our family of faith begin to reconnect, re-engage, and practice living in beloved community again. Frankly, something many of us have forgotten how to do. And we both agreed that to do this, we really needed to provide opportunity for folks to know each other, getting past our social media highlight reels. Earl and I agreed that cultivating a culture of trust and vulnerability was of the utmost importance. One of the ways we decided to work at this was through the practice of witness and testimony with what we are calling the To Know and Be Known Bench. Each Sunday morning during worship, a parishioner and I sit down on an old pew, which has been removed for today's service, and we have a short conversation. I ask them a question, something which requires the individual to be a bit vulnerable and to trust that the community will hold what they share in grace and love. As a way of modeling this for the congregation, Earl agreed to go first. And so 2 weeks ago, 13 days ago, we sat down together and I asked him, "What is your greatest fear?" What we wanted to get at was that even those who reside in the upper stratospheres of leadership can be afraid. Just because you hold positions of power and authority, you can still experience fear. And so that's why we decided upon that question. And you know what Earl said? One of his greatest fears in life is? He said that his greatest fear was that his instincts weren't always as good, pure, and holy as he thought they should be. And then to illustrate what he meant, he told this wonderful story about a time that he and Tammy were traveling out of state. He went into a store to buy something, and when he came out, Tammy told him about a woman she had met in the parking lot who was in dire need of money to pay for another night in the hotel where she and her children were staying. Sensing a connection while Earl was in the store, Tammy gave the woman the cash needed to cover the cost. Earl told us a couple of Sundays ago that he was indignant, and Ted said to Tammy, "You know there is about a 50% chance that woman is buying drugs with that money right now." To which Tammy replied, "Great. Because that means there's a 50% chance she's back at the hotel tucking her child in for the night." Earl said one of his greatest fears was his instinct was that his instinct to hoard the love and grace of God wouldn't allow him to connect with other human beings in the way he knew Jesus commanded, love others as I have loved you. Or as our gospel reading states, if you know me and follow my ways, then you know God and are walking in God's paths of righteousness. Friends, 2 weeks ago in this very space, Earl was real and raw. And I believe that his vulnerability and the way he trusted us to hold what he shared speaks volumes about the man he was. First and above all else, Earl was a man of deep and abiding faith. His faith sustained him, and his faith compelled him. In times of sadness and in pain, in times of challenge, when he found himself walking through life's valleys, Earl turned to the word of God for comfort and reassurance. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup overflows. And from Jeremiah, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. He was a giant among men, but he still walked through the valleys. And then, in times of great joy, Earl delighted in God's promises. Praise God's name with dancing and make music with timbrel and harp, for God delights in God's people. God crowns the humble with victory. And we know how much Earl liked to dance. But Earl's faith, yes, with Tammy. I was looking at her. But friends, Earl's faith was not simply a private endeavor about personal salvation. As I said, Earl's faith compelled him. It compelled him, as the prophet Micah declared, to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly. As a tireless advocate for the marginalized, he strove to lift everyone up in this world that we would keep down. I will add here, Earl was an advocate for us in female leadership at this church. He loved us. He made us better. He was constantly supporting us, telling us we got it. Go be who you were created to be. Second, Earl believed with all his heart in the transformative power of beloved community. In fact, I dare to say that at times Earl had more faith in us than we sometimes do in ourselves. Tammy, I know that you and Earl had that beautiful passage from 1 Corinthians 13 read at your wedding, a harbinger of your life together, I believe. But here's the deal. In that letter, Paul was writing not to an individual, but Paul was writing to the early church in Corinth, a community that was having, let's say, at least a few issues. While Paul was writing Corinth, The early church was deeply, deeply divided. Half-truths and false truths were flying around. And the people of Corinth were not treating people very well. And so Paul wrote this letter to remind them of the importance of community, of the importance of love, of a love that is patient and kind, of a love that isn't envious or boastful or rude, a love that does not dishonor others, a love that is not angry and doesn't keep record of wrongdoing. Paul wrote about a love that protects, trusts, hopes, and always, always perseveres. Earl believed that when our communities are rooted in this kind of divine love, we are in possession of everything we need to change the world. Beloveds, I don't know why bad things happen in this world. I don't know why tragedy befalls us. I don't know why Earl was called home at the age of 55. I was his pastor, and he was my friend. He was my advisor. He was my partner in holy disruption. Together we worked hard and we laughed often. Church people can be kind of absurd. And we were always on the lookout for how God was showing up in the world and in our community. So I don't know. I don't know why things like this happen. But what I do know is that the way in which we honor Earl's life is by carrying forth his legacy, his love of God, and his love of community, his trust in the Lord and his trust in each one of you, his faith in the Spirit and his faith in the Spirit which is in this very place. Right before Jesus was arrested and ultimately crucified, he gathered with those he loved most in the world, and he began to try to prepare them for all of the horror that was to come. And as he was talking with his disciples, he said, "In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not true, I wouldn't tell you it is so. And I am going to prepare a place for you so that where I am, you also shall be." And then Jesus said, "And when I see you again, when I see you again, our joy will be complete, and no one will take it from us." I don't know why bad things happen. But what I am absolutely sure of is that in this moment, Earl Evans Exum is residing in the loving arms of God. And I truly believe he is dancing his way through the gates of heaven, delighting in the joy of the Lord as he hears the triumphant cry, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And may we who love him, spend whatever hours, days, weeks, months, years we have upon this earth, doing justice, loving kindness, and building the beloved community Earl tirelessly sought after. Because, Earl, my friend, you need not fear. You had all the right instincts. Amen. Friends, receive now the benediction. May each one of us go knowing that we are made in the image of God, blessed, deemed good, and loved unconditionally. May each one of us know that we go with the power of a living Christ, the power of the one who lives among us, who leads us forward. And may each one of us know that we are imprinted with the Spirit, that the Spirit of God resides in us. So let us go in all that we do, in all that we say. Let us go forth sharing God's love with a world so, so in need. In the name of God, our Creator, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and by the power of the Spirit, world without end. Amen. Amen. Amen.